minutes after 10 o'clock in the morning. And welcome to our regular Tuesday feature. Now, anybody would know that this is the anthem for newborn babies. But sometimes, unfortunately, they aren't all born well, and they're not all, and some of them are born before their time. So the topic of the day would be the field of neonatology. And I am happy to bring to you your healthcare partners, brought to you by GRMC, where patients are partners. And introducing in the studio, Vanessa Consina. Dr. Vanessa Consina. Hi, how are you? Would you mind just bringing that whole thing down? Let me hold the stand while you... There you go. You're going to move this. It's like a joint right there. Okay. There you go. Well,
That's good.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Good morning,
everybody. Good morning. Then Dr. Katrina Ebonia.
Good morning.
Good morning to you. You guys don't look old enough to be delivering babies. I mean, taking care of babies. Like, you are babies still.
I always get that.
You always get that. There's something, you guys both have a youthful appearance, but you have years. How many years combined experience do you have as neonatologists?
Combined for us?
Well, we started pediatrics residency first, so that's 3 years, and another training for neonatology for 3 more years, so that's a total of 6 years.
Yeah,
for each of us. For combined, we've had like 12 years.
Yeah, 12 years. Yeah. Well, I mean, still. I was saying when you guys were still out there waiting that this is an interesting specialty because you really do have to have thicker skin, a stronger stomach, and it's tough on a daily basis. Is it in all of medicine, would you say that pediatrics is probably the one that really, you know, has the ability to bring such joy and to bring such sorrow all at the same time?
I think in every medical field, you have that both feeling of sorrow and happiness that come at the same time. The only thing different, particularly with our field, like in neonatology, is we deal with very, very small babies most of the time. So there is that feeling of they're not even supposed to be born yet, or not even supposed to be breathing by themselves, but they are here now. So there's that extra emotional.
Sure.
What do you call that?
Yeah.
Happiness or sorrow.
Do you find that you work that much harder? That there is a different sort of, there's something else that drives you where that emotion comes from? I know that medicine as a science is what it is. But there has to be another motivating factor that can allow you to keep coming back or even gain more expertise and education in your field.
Probably the thought that the first few hours of a sick baby is very critical. So that motivation to act on right away to save that baby is crucial because that can affect long term.
Sure. So we're talking about, let's first talk about prematurity. What are some of the causes or some of the most common causes of premature births?
Well, preterm labor, definitely. And preterm labor can be caused by a lot of things. Maternal illnesses. One would be hypertension, uncontrolled hypertension, or diabetes that is uncontrolled, or any illnesses that mom has, even infections, can cause preterm labor, thereby leading to preterm delivery.
But are there instances where the premature babies are born not because of the mother, that perfectly healthy mothers can still have premature babies?
Yeah. So the ultimate cause of premature labor itself. So premature births are caused by premature labor.
Right.
But the most common cause of premature labor usually is there's nothing specific. Like what Dr. Ebonia said, it can be because of infection or anything maternal.
Yeah. Can it be something that has developed during the pregnancy? Or maybe like gestational diabetes, for example?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yes,
so definitely. You could have a perfectly healthy mother, but during that gestation, she may develop some other complications.
Yes.
I see. And when that happens, the OB usually will keep extra It would seem to me.
On the moms.
On them. I see. Yeah,
that's why it's very important that moms, whenever they find out that they're pregnant, their first impulse is they have to be seen by a doctor because they would have to be monitored closely, because anytime, even if they feel they're healthy or they feel they're the same as their non-pregnant self, there are still some issues that can come up and then the OB will be the one who's going to identify that and guide them through.
So how do you determine what prematurity is? Like, is it you know, the weeks of gestation, or is it the baby's ability to survive outside the womb with the development of its lungs?
Yeah, usually the gestational age, it is measured through the last menstrual period of the mom.
Right.
And then we just count the number of days after that. Also, serial ultrasounds can help us estimate the gestational age as well as the estimated fetal weight. So that will give us an idea of how the baby's going to do if she had a preterm. Yeah. Mom had a preterm delivery.
But that's not something that is standard, is it? Is it standard? Do OBs, like, monitor or take all of these measurements and statistics in order to determine in 40 weeks or 40 weeks, ideally, right?
Mm-hmm. So 37 to 40 weeks is the one that's called term.
Okay.
Term or full-term babies.
Right, right.
Anything that's less than that
than 37
is premature.
Weeks. Okay. And what is the organ that develops last? Is it fully develops that would make the difference between survivability?
So the thing is, around 34 weeks of gestation or during that time, most or all of the organs are already fully formed. The question is, how functional are they? So that's the reason why most babies are wanted to be delivered around 37 to 40 weeks, because even if they're fully formed around 34 weeks, some of them are not fully functional. In particular, are their lungs.
Yeah.
So some of them are, they already have fully formed lungs, but they're not fully functional. So they have that extra week.
Is that the difference between those last 3 weeks? Is the lungs becoming functional?
Yes, definitely matters. And even now, like in the studies, like when you say 37 weeks, it's still considered early term. So even 37 weeks is term.
Yeah. Ideally, you want those 3 weeks. Yeah.
Yeah.
You still want those three weeks to continue for
it
the...
It matters.
Absolutely it matters. And I had a friend who spent the last 6 months of her term in bed, monitored with machines on her at her house and monitored by a nearby hospital. Is that any kind of technology that you have here?
As far as like having monitors at home, I don't think that's available at this
point. That's not available yet. Okay.
Yeah. But usually any time that a mother that the OB thinks are very high risk or like needs to be monitored closely and are under term, they usually have to stay in the hospital until they get more stable.
I had a friend most recently, her daughter spent the last 2 or 3 months in the hospital, you know, being monitored. I mean, I said, boy, what are you complaining about? That, you know, that last 3 months of pregnancy, right? It's like that is that time when you just want to lay down all day long.
Yeah.
Can you talk to me about the equipment that you have at the NICU now? What kind of technology do you have?
So we have incubators. We have incubators. We have mechanical ventilators. We have
mechanical ventilators.
Yes. So these mechanical ventilators are hooked to a tube, and this tube is hooked to the baby, placed on the baby by us. So that's helping the baby breathe.
Okay. So, which is different than what?
So some babies have a milder form of respiratory distress, so they don't need the mechanical ventilator.
They just need a mask?
Sometimes they need we call it like a cannula.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So that's
oh,
for the
milder. That's the difference between the tube going into the nose, into the lungs.
Yes.
I see.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
So those are for the more critical babies, especially those who are less than 28 weeks. Definitely, most likely, they end up being intubated.
Yeah, okay.
But of course, if you can try to avoid that because of the complications associated with it, we will try to.
Mm-hmm. I see. Incubators, have there been more advances in that kind of technology? Because it would seem to me that incubators are kind of incubators, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, there's no. They're warming machines?
Yeah, basically. Yeah. That's the whole philosophy of incubators. I guess the more advanced kind of incubators that we have right now is this, the kind of setups that would allow the providers to, like, work on the baby while without losing any heat for the baby.
Oh.
So that's the most advanced ones that are available now. Mm-hmm. Because, again, losing heat is very critical for a baby. So as much as possible, you don't want them to get cold.
Yeah. And that's heat that's matching the human temperature that they might be in if they were in utero.
Still. Exactly. Okay. It's more of like to control the baby's heat. So it's like they are inside mom's uterus.
Right. What's the temperature? What's the surviving temperature? I never even... Is it the same as the body temperature?
Basically, you want it around
98.
Yeah, you want to keep it within normal.
Yeah. Yes. And normal, I mean, it's the mother's temperature is what the temperature is when the baby's in the uterus. So you're... Right?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yes.
Basically,
yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But we have to understand because these preterm babies, they have thinner skin, so they can lose heat easily as compared to us. So that's why you want to control their temperature so... You don't. They don't lose too much heat.
Yeah.
So even in the delivery, in the first 30 minutes, we already put them in a wrap.
Yeah.
We already put like a chemical mattress, a warming mattress underneath.
Yeah.
And then we transfer right away to the incubator while we're transporting.
Yeah. So now, do you have to if you have to perform surgeries? How do you, is that still on the, what are the conditions if, in that case?
So in that case, we don't really perform surgeries. What we do is we do certain procedures, like we put umbilical lines in their umbilicus. That's more for like infusion of fluids, like to give fluids, to give nutrition. Intubations also are putting in the breathing tube down their throat. We also do it within that area. So that's why we control the temperature. But if they ever, like, babies needed to go undergo surgeries.
They don't perform the surgery, the procedure in the incubator. No. They actually have to put them on a table to. But the climate, with that, how is that also controlled in an open room?
But most of the time, since if babies are not, even if they're small, like they, even if, I'm sorry, even if they need to have surgeries, usually the surgeons won't do anything on them because they're too small. So the risks are also too high. So most often, if they're that too small to have their temperatures get controlled, they stay in the incubator.
I see. Yeah. I see. Mm-hmm. Well, in your line of work, what are some of the conditions that you see in premature babies? What are we talking about? We're talking about obviously help breathing.
Well, apart from the prematurity, a lot of infection, sepsis, because of their immature immune system, so they're more likely to get infections. So we really get critical bugs, and then we start them with antibiotics. Apart from that, of course, the respiratory distress is a critical thing. We sometimes give a chemical to the lungs. We infuse it via the breathing tube to help open up the airways.
Yeah.
Another issue is like for the premature babies, like head bleeds.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we monitor. We're doing ultrasounds of the head to check if the bleedings are getting bigger and bigger. Basically, it's more of like all the systems are all immature.
Yeah.
So all of the systems have complications.
Complications. Yeah. Talk to me about your actual department. Now, is that a connected to pediatrics, or how can you want to explain how that layout is?
The division of neonatology is under the Department of Pediatrics. So what we do here is we take care of like the very premature baby, meaning the very small babies, up to like even full term babies that are critical, meaning they're sick enough when they were born.
Mm-hmm.
So we keep them in the ICU, in the neonatal ICU, for a couple of days until they get better. It's a closed unit, meaning like we are very much into infection control. We have certain guidelines that we follow just so that we are make sure that we fall into that control of the infection risks for these babies. Because again, their immune system is very low, so they can get any kind of infection by whatever. So we are very much into that. Now, we are composed of like NICU or neonatal nurses that are, they have experience with this kind of little babies and critical babies. Apart from us, Dr. Ibonia, we also have respiratory therapists that are, those are the ones that are specialized in like breathing
issues.
Breathing issues,
Do you have a lot of babies currently in the unit?
Currently, we have four. We have four right now. One is intubated. Three on the milder form of ventilation. But sometimes we have four now. And the next hour,
it fluctuates.
It just depends.
Yeah, it just depends.
But you also know what's incoming, though, right? By the point.
No.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Sometimes no. Sometimes a mom walks in labor, and in 1 minute, the baby's out.
Oh, but I mean, the patients that you might be receiving might have had already been vetted because they know that there is an issue in utero, right?
So that's one issue that I think is an issue in the island is some of our mothers, they don't really receive prenatal care. So most of the time, they walk in. They don't even know how many weeks they are pregnant.
They're just, see.
So those are the things that
Cases that you have now. Is that
that's the most frequent one?
Frequently we get those.
So they just sort of come through the door and they're in labor and they've never had any prenatal care. They've never no vitamins, no checkups. That's the dangerous one. Isn't
there was even a time that we didn't know that it was a twin delivery.
Oh.
The OB just felt like they did an ultrasound and then, okay, there's two babies in there. We're going to go to the OR.
And the mother didn't know
the
that she
didn't
had
know that she's
twins.
Going to have.
Yeah. That must be frustrating on your end, though.
Yes.
Definitely.
Because, of course, you want the best for the baby.
Yeah.
And, of course, the best for the baby starts in utero. So if mom had illnesses during the pregnancy and not monitored, that's going to affect the baby.
It's also frustrating because sometimes we get like moms that have several babies already and they on the last baby they don't get prenatal care. So you would assume that the previous babies they never really get prenatal care.
How long have you guys been at GRMC?
So I've been since July 2016.
Okay.
I started last year.
You started last year. Yeah. Now, you came from where then?
From Kentucky.
Both of you came from Kentucky. That's a long way.
Yeah, I know.
But I'm assuming you're close to home, closer to home.
Yeah,
Was that always the idea? Was like you graduated and then you went to the mainland and you continued your studies there. Was it always your idea to go closer to home or to be at home?
Actually, in my case, it was more of like family issue because my husband is in the Philippines. So the whole time I was in the States, he just has to come back and forth. It's so kind of too much hassle. So we looked at places that we can go to that's midway, and we found GRMC. So and then I dragged her
and then
along.
So she told you about it.
Yes, she told me.
She
about
made
it.
You uproot your family too.
She talked to my husband.
Well, that's good. I mean, honestly, you're like twin doctors now over at GR. You're going to get the tag team.
I know.
Pretty much.
We've been friends for like seven, eight years.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, then you both can read each other's specialty.
Yes.
You know what you're.
And that helps a lot.
Yeah. To know what everybody's capabilities are.
Yeah.
Yeah. You have good staff down there too.
Oh, great.
NICU. Yeah.
Great staff.
I honestly think that it just takes a certain personality. There's something a little bit extra in the DNA humanity, because this can be a very sad job. Well, I'm glad to see you smiling through this all, and we appreciate your professionalism at GRMC. And it looks like you guys have found a great home to stay and treat island babies with illnesses or have been delivered prematurely. Well, I learned so much. Thank
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
It was great to meet you, and I hope to come by one day and take a look at the unit and see what it looks like. I'll take that magic tour. All right. Appreciate that. It's about 6 minutes now before the top of the hour. That was your Healthcare Partners, brought to you by GRMC, where patients are partners. Tuesday.